हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल?
सर
यस, माय स्लाइड्स आर विजिबल?
यस यस
ओके, सो हार्ट फेलियर वाज ड्यू टू द पंप रिडक्शन ऑफ द पंपिंग फेलियर ऑफ द पंपिंग फंक्शन ऑफ द हार्ट इज नोन सिंस द एंशिएंट एजेस फ्रॉम द इजिप्शियन एंड द ग्रीक सिविलाइजेशन, बट द पंप हैज अनदर फंक्शन. That is to receive blood according to the need of the body and according to the adequate amount, which was known since, which was there since birth of the heart, but it was only appreciated later in the 1937 when Dr. Fishberg wrote cardiac insufficiency resulting from inadequate filling of the heart. However, the syndrome of diastolic heart failure, where the reception of the blood in the heart is inadequate, was not recognized till 1980s. So it is just like a human nature. Though both the function were born at the same time, some talents are recognized later. So what is heart failure with preserved ejection fraction? Heart failure and preserved ejection fraction is a heterogeneous syndrome with clinical signs and symptoms of congestive heart failure with impaired diastolic function, that is elevated intracardiac pressure at rest or during stress. This is very important. And the normal or near normal ejection fraction. This is a definition, though it is not a very elaborate definition. It was given by Harper in 2018. So what is the epidemiology? Globally, it is found that accounts for this heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, or in short, HFPEF, accounts for around 30 to 75% of the heart failure cases. It affects generally the older people, more than 65 years, and females are mostly affected. And mortality in this population is often due to non-cardiac cases. If we look at the Indian data, we will find that the in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is reported to 25% of the total heart failure burden. But I must say, and from our experience also, and from the correlating the global data, that it is highly underrated and underreported. Probably the total burden would be much more, nearly around 50%. And heart failure is more prevalent in females also. It is concurrent with the global data, and prognosis appears to be worse than of the West. That this is very important, because we will see later that the mortality of the heart failure with preserved ejection fraction does not depend on the heart failure itself. It depends on the concomitant factors or concomitant comorbidities. Patients present with heart failure at younger age compared to the West, that was probably due to endomyocardial fibrosis in India, which is also a vanishing mystery. People say that initially, 20 years earlier, there was a huge a chunk of population which used to have endomyocardial fibrosis in Kerala and Trivandrum, and these patients has gradually reduced, probably due to the lifestyle modifications. And prevalence of these factors differs, as because India is the capital of diabetes and hypertension, there is more prevalent. So probably the heart failure with preserved ejection fraction will be more in our country. If we look at the Kaplan-Meier survival curve of the preserved ejection fraction and reduced ejection fraction heart failure, we will see the mortality same. But there is a very interesting point in this curve. The mortality and morbidity of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction depends on the admission of heart failure and mortality due to heart failure in cases of reduced ejection fraction. Whereas with preserved ejection fraction, the mortality and morbidity depends on the concomitant comorbidities rather than the heart failure itself. So with that in mind, how the comorbidity and comorbidity takes place in a heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, and how they manipulate the syndrome of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. We will see that the comorbidities are the risk factors for developing heart failure, as well as complicating factors when the heart failure develops. The mortality and morbidity in heart failure preserved ejection fraction depends on the comorbidity presence. Hospitalization and largely due, as I have already told you, that hospitalization is largely due to the comorbid conditions, and there is a lower rate of hospitalization and mortality due to heart failure in preserved ejection fraction, but higher rate of hospitalization due to non-heart failure cases, contrary to the heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. Now, what are the comorbidities? Number one is coronary artery disease, present in 25 to 50%. But if there is a very interesting point again in coronary artery disease incidence in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. In heart failure and reduced ejection fraction, you will see a lot of epicardial coronary arteries which are diseased. And we have seen that heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, if the epicardial coronary artery disease is treated with revascularization, the heart failure improves. But in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, usually the epicardial coronary arteries are not diseased. And if we see the in the angiogram, we will see that there is very slow flow in the coronary arteries, suggesting that there is microvascular lesion in the coronary arteries, probably due to a lot of factors which we will discuss later on. Besides this, hypertension is the most prevalent risk factor. It affects, and we will see that, it affects 75 to 85% of the patients who present with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, and it also precedes a heart failure diagnosis. So it is the most important factor in genesis of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Once the heart failure of preserved ejection fraction develops, atrial fibrillation is present in 2/3 of the patients, and it is poorly tolerated, as you know, and we will see in the pathophysiology that the atrial function is highly necessary to push blood into the circulation and push blood inside the heart. And once there is an atrial fibrillation, the atrial function is lost and the patients are deteriorating fast. Anemia and renal function, and particularly chronic renal failure, develops, and we call it a cardiorenal syndrome. It develops in 30 to 60% of the people who present with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. And also, along with it, there is also the incidence of chronic obstructive pulmonary artery disease. And also, as a genetic genesis, and a very important role in genesis is the obesity and diabetes mellitus. Obesity is present in 50% of the patients of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, and the incidence is independent of the development of ischemic heart disease. And this obesity leads to RV dysfunction, and this is an extracardiac cause of volume overload and sodium retention, leading to increased blood volume. And also, obesity causes systemic inflammation with the involvement of the epicardial fat tissue, and which leads to myocardial fibrosis, diastolic dysfunction, diminished release of BNP, and increased secretion of neprilysin and aldosterone. And associated with obesity, if there is diabetes, particularly in if it is present with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, there is an increased morbidity and mortality, and diabetes is responsible with 60% increase in death and hospitalization. And it also involves the involvement of the RAS, poor calcium handling in the cardiac myocytes, oxidative stress, and microvascular disease. So normally, 70 to 80% of the, we know that normally 70 to 80% of the LV filling occurs in the fast rapid filling phase due to the sudden recoil of the heart muscles. And this is due to the continuous decline of the LVP and the continuous decline of the LV pressure after the mitral valve opening. And then from the blood comes from the LA to LV without any increase in LA pressure with the gradient, as because there is a continuous thinning of the myocardium. So the gradient is maintained without any increasing LA pressure. And heart failure in preserved ejection fraction, this relaxation of mechanism is impaired, and the early diastolic pressure is increased. So the LA pressure gets increased, and that leads to increased pulmonary venous pressure. And LV filling is pushed towards a later phase of diastole, particularly that becomes atrial filling, atrial contraction related. And we know that only 20 to 25% of the LV filling in diastole happens due to atrial kick, and in heart failure with preserved systolic function, or heart failure with preserved EF, that this LV pressure related LV filling comes to more than 50%. So most of the filling appears in the later part of the diastole, and it is highly related to LV function. So when there is a hypertension, when there is obesity and other, when there is diabetes mellitus, these three comorbidities act synergistically. Hypertension leads to chronic concentric remodeling of the LV, leading to left ventricular hypertrophy, impaired relaxation, and myocardial fibrosis. Whereas diabetes, obesity, they lead to systemic inflammation, and particularly coronary endothelial inflammation, leading to decreased nitric oxide bioavailability, decreased cyclic GMP content, and decreased protein kinase G activity, leading to, again, the impaired relaxation and myocardial fibrosis, leading to heart failure in with preserved ejection fraction. And you look at the pressure volume loop of the diastole, and when there is a impaired diastolic relaxation in the third phase, you see curve, you will see that with little increase in volume leads to high LV pressure in diastole. And there, when there the diastolic pressure is increased, due to the upward and leftward shift of the diastolic pressure volume curve, the LV diastolic pressure increases, the pulmonary venous pressure increases, that leads to pulmonary venous congestion. At the same time, it reduces the systolic volume, stroke volume, and decreases the cardiac output. So the cardiac output mainly depends on the rate, heart rate, and it becomes the fixed cardiac output. Beyond diastolic function, there are other abnormalities which are also apparent in heart failure in preserved ejection fraction, as for example, systolic dysfunction, chronotropic incompetence, autonomic imbalance, left atrial dysfunction, RV dysfunction, and skeletal muscle dysfunction. Particularly, RV dysfunction and left atrial dysfunction leads to disaster because they are related to morbidity and mortality. So how we diagnose? We diagnose according to a diagnostic algorithm. It is called PEFF. First, the symptoms and the comorbidities, then the BNP and echocardiogram, then the confirmatory test like diagnostic stress test or invasive test, and last is the etiological diagnosis. So we go to the first. Symptoms are very common symptoms of heart failure. Everybody knows that. Dyspnea, orthopnea, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, fatigue, reduced exercise tolerance. These are the very important symptoms. Our signs like in elevated JBP, hepatojugular reflux, presence of S3 or S4, pulmonary crackles or displaced apex. If these symptoms and signs are present, something should be excluded. Number one, the heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, the valve disease, the constrictive pericarditis, and high output failure. This should be excluded first. And if, after exclusion of these, if the symptoms and signs are present, the heart failure is diagnosed, then we go to the pre-test probability. That depends on the comorbidities. What are the comorbidities? Like age more than 60, hypertension, obesity, diabetes, chronic renal failure, atrial fibrillation, OSA, and COPD. Depending on the presence of these pre-test probabilities, if it is a high probability, we will go for a BNP test or NT-proBNP test. And if it is increased, we go for an echo and all. And if it is low, then if there is symptoms are persisting, we go for the confirmatory testing. But we need to have a few words about proBNP and BNP. proBNP and BNP are not always high in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, because in heart failure and reduced ejection fraction, there is always an increase in BNP and proBNP. But the concomitant association with obesity, which reduces BNP release, and sometimes with other varieties that which increase the BNP release, like atrial fibrillation, there is always a balance. And normal BNP does not rule out heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Echocardiography. Next is echocardiography. The most important part of echocardiography is that it is the diagnostic parameter. If in presence of symptoms, echocardiography shows these diagnostic parameters, it is almost confirmatory to diagnose heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. What we see in the ejection fraction echocardiography is the LV mass index, which should be more than 115 grams per meter square in male and more than 95 grams per meter square in female. LA volume index, more than 34 milliliter per meter square in meter square, and RWT, that is a measurement of the posterior wall of the ventricle, and it should be more than 0.45. Functional, by Doppler, we see that our diastolic function and pulmonary artery systolic pressure should be worked out. And depending on that, again, we go for a major criteria and minor criteria. These are all echocardiographic criteria. I'm not going into details of it, but if these major criteria are present, every criteria is a 2 point and a minor criteria is 1 point. If the there is 5 points in favor of 5 points present, then we diagnose it as heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. If it is 2 to 4 points, then diastolic stress test and other acute tests should be done. But what are the other accurate tests? Number one, we can go for a stress echo, because we, after that, exercise, if you do the echo and if you see that the points are changing towards heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, it is diagnostic. Otherwise, if the echocardiogram does not show the confirmatory values, then you can go for an invasive test, that is the right heart catheterization. And after saline infusion, after if you give 500 saline infusion and then do the right heart test, and that would be a, exercise test for invasive measurements. And if that shows that there is a significant increase in PCWP, more than 25 millimeter mercury, then you diagnose the case as heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Final is the etiologic diagnosis. And you have to see, this is important for, real cases, real rare cases like, endomyocardial fibrosis, or where you suspect some of the amyloidosis, etc. Then you can go for CMR, or you can go for angiography for to rule out coronary artery disease. So how to treat them? The most important is, this is a phenotype. The 4 points are important. Number one is CAD. Number two is pulmonary hypertension. Number three is obesity. And number four is aging. They rotate under the central point of hypertension. So these 5 points are very important. And treat them accordingly. Otherwise, you will end up in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, which we do not have any answer. So treat each comorbidity separately and see what happens. First is systemic hypertension. So systemic hypertension should be, that leads to concentric hypertrophy and concentric remodeling. So use some drugs which prevents concentric hypertrophy and concentric remodeling. What are the drugs? AC inhibitor, ARB, diuretics, and vasodilating beta blocker as a first line agents. Then you move to calcium channel blockers, particularly the non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers are better. Next is obesity. Diet counseling, etc. Obesity must be reduced. If there is an obese person, he has got a very dismal prognosis with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. So obesity should be controlled very tightly and very meticulously. Next is OSA. We often, do not see, we oversee this, the effects of OSA. If there is an OSA, the heart failure of preserved ejection fraction leads to RV systolic dysfunction. And once RV systolic dysfunction develops, then the prognosis of the patient is actually dismal. So we need to suspect OSA and take the help of a sleep therapist and use CPAP and other things to limit the obstructive sleep apnea and to limit its deleterious effects on heart failure with preserved systolic function. Next is coronary artery disease. As I have told you that coronary artery, epicardial coronary artery diseases are rare, but if it is present, then you need to go for revascularization. Otherwise, you go with medications and particularly aspirin and statins in all patients, unless contraindicated for primary and secondary prevention of the myocardial infarction. Atrial fibrillation, another very important factor. So again, we atrial fibrillation, the rate control and rhythm control, there are a lot of controversies, but rate control with beta blockers and non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers is enough, and anticoagulation with NOACs should be continued. Chronic kidney disease, again, you need to go, address that. And we will come to the newer drugs which can prevent chronic kidney disease in diabetic and preserve systolic function. We will see that later on. Chronic lung disease, again, you need to need the help of pulmonologists to treat them. And ultimately, the main management of the, once the heart failure with preserved ejection fraction has established, these are the 5 points which you need. One is avoid tachycardia. Number two, control blood pressure. Number three, optimize cardiac and non-cardiac conditions like comorbidity treatment. Number four is diuretics, because diuretics can reduce symptomatology, and exercise training is similarly important, because exercise training will increase oxygenation as well as reduce obesity. There are two very important drugs which will be effective, and they are emerging as pharmacotherapies for heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Number one is SGLT2 inhibitors. They increase the urinary glucose excretion by blocking transporters, which absorb sodium and glucose, And that's why they will allow the fats to be burned rather than sugar. And meta-analysis of the trials of 3 SGLT2 inhibitors in diabetes mellitus, along with showed that EMPA-REG outcome, CANVAS program, and declared TIMI-58 demonstrated that robust decrease in hospitalization with heart failure, that is 23%, and progression of renal disease 45%, regardless of the heart failure and CAD. So this drug can change the perspective of comorbidity dependent heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. If they are used early in diabetes, probably the renal failure and development of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction can be changed. Mechanism responsible: they diminish blood glucose, they diminish blood pressure, diminish uric acid, and also they do cardioprotection by sodium hydrogen exchange in heart and kidneys, reduce epicardial adipocytes, and these epicardial adipocytes leads to leptin mediated inflammation and fibrosis, and they reduce obesity. So by this, probably they change the perspective of heart failure in preserved systolic function. The last is ARNI, and which is more used in heart failure in reduced ejection fraction, but also in patients with hypertension, obesity, and diabetes. This combination, sacubitril valsartan, blocks the myocardial fibrosis. It is found that they block the myocardial fibrosis, and they diminish the microvascular dysfunction in coronary arteries by increasing the nitric oxide dependent cyclic GMP and PKG activity, and they reduce the cardiac remodeling. So with that, probably they will be helpful in heart failure with preserved systolic function. And there were 3 trials which were tried, Parallax, Paramount, and Paradigm HF. And they do not have the statistical benefit and statistical significance to develop a guideline, but probably these are the emerging therapy in the future. So to conclude, heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is a heterogeneous syndrome. Treatment should be directed from prevention and control of the comorbidities rather than going for the established heart failure with preserved heart failure. And when there is an established heart failure in these patients, it needs only diuretics to control the symptoms, but other therapies are largely inadequate, and the myocardial damage is beyond repair. So it is always better to have a prevention rather than cure. Thank you for.